We're going to talk about 10.1 today, which is radicals and radical functions. So we'll be dealing with, in 10.1, perfect roots. We'll be talking about domain again, which has also been something we've talked about on two other tests. We will also talk about graphing. So the first thing I want to suggest is that you start getting very familiar with the perfect squares and some perfect cubes. So this is something I actually recommend you data dumping. So what I mean by that is, like, have a piece of paper, but make sure you're memorizing them. And yes, totally get it. You have a calculator that can do this for you, but you need to start recognizing these perfect squares and perfect cubes. So I've just listed some of the most common ones that you have here in this case. So 1 squared is 1, and a lot of people forget that one, okay? Meaning like they, just like when we deal with difference of squares, it's easy to forget. 1 squared is 1, 2 squared is 4, 3 squared is 9, 4 squared, 16, 5 squared, 25, 6 squared, 36, 7 squared, 49, 8 squared, 64, 9 squared, 81, 10 squared, 100, 11 squared, 121, 12 squared should be 144, 15 squared is 225. I strongly recommend you having these kind of listed on the top of the papers when you're taking quizzes and tests. And what I mean by that is data dump it right when you get your paper, right when you start. Practice doing this because these are the most common you're going to see. This is going to help throughout this whole chapter. Also for this section, we're going to deal with some perfect cubes. I would suggest at least knowing the first 5 numbers. So 1 cubed is 1, 2 cubed is 8, 3 cubed, 3 times 3 times 3 is 27, 4 cubed, which is 4 times 4 times 4 is 64, 5 cubed, 5 times 5 times 5, so that should be 125. Now there are some other ones, obviously you'll see a lot, but again, as a minimum, you want to be comfortable with these so that you're quicker on using those pieces. So strongly recommend at the beginning of each homework assignment, write these down. Again, a lot of y'all think you know them, but you want to be super comfortable with them as you do these problems. So going back to our 10.1 notes, this section again is dealing with roots of numbers. So remember that you need to be careful if it just asked in words, what is the square root of 4? This is a reminder coming back from 0028 as well. If it said it in words, the square root of 4 is actually a negative 2 and a positive 2, because we're asking truly what can we square and get 4. When we deal with the radical notation, we are dealing with asking for what's called the principal root. So square root of a number is going to be asking for the positive answer. So what is coming out of the square root should be a positive. That's not to say that you can't have a negative answer if the negative is in front. So this is again a reminder of, remember to be careful about knowing the difference of where the negative is. Is the negative included or not? That's going to be a really important question for this section. So we have some, again, some just kind of highlights here. Also making sure you understand the notation. The n is my root or my index. What's underneath is my radicand. Okay. The whole piece is my radical. So again, what we're asking on number 1 is what can we raise to the 3rd power and get 64? That is one of our perfect roots, so that's the number 4. Number 2, what can we raise to the 3rd power that would give me 125? That's my 5. Now, we haven't talked about number 3. Number 3 says, what can I raise to the 4th power to get 16? The powers of 2 are really common ones they like to ask a lot of. So remember, 2 squared is 4. 2 cubed means multiply 4 times 2, which gives me 8. 2 to the 4th, multiply again by another 2, which gives me 16. And they even will go up sometimes to the power of 5, because again, that's a common one. So remember to use the idea, if you're not sure when you're guessing and checking, if it's an even number or an odd number, use that to help you guess. So my answer for number three should be two. And same idea for number four. The answer there should be two. If you're not sure, guess and check. It's not hard to rewrite it. Remember, what we are doing is we're backwards raising something to an exponent, essentially. So this actually meant 2 to the 5th equals 32. So that, remember, means 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2. That's what I actually did. So this is just a reminder. Okay? We're asking, what would we raise to that power to get to that to get to that answer of the radicand, which is underneath. So going to number 5, we have a fraction, which tends to throw y'all off. Your brains tend to say, wait, what are we doing? But again, most of you won't show this step, but this is really truly what you're doing. You're taking the cube root of 8, and you're taking the cube root of 27. So the cube root of 8 is 2, cube root of 27 is 3. That's my answer. Now, 6 throws people off as well, because now we're dealing with decimals. But what I say is break the idea up. First say to yourself, okay, if I didn't have decimals, what would be the square root of 25? Most of y'all should answer 5. So we know 5 is involved. Now we've got to figure out the decimals. So remember, when we're multiplying decimals, we multiply the numbers, and then we count up how many decimals, and that's how many are in our answer. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4 decimal places. So since I'm dealing with the square root, and so the number has to be the same number for both when we're multiplying it together, because again, we're saying, what do we raise square to get 0.0025? We've already said there needs to be a 5 in there. Now we need to figure out how many decimals. So there are 4. So since we're dealing with the square root, let's half it, which is 2, but let's double check that in our calculator. And you should see that that worked. So my answer for that problem is 0.05. So talking about principal roots that I mentioned earlier, when we see a square root symbol, they're actually asking for a principal root, which is the quote-unquote positive root. Again, because if I square a negative or a positive number, I should get the same answer. But when we're going backwards, when we see a square root, we are only asking for the positive answer. So you do need to be careful, where is the negative in these? Again, it goes back to the idea of when we had negatives with exponential format. When we had exponential format, remember, if I had a negative 3 squared or if I had a negative 3 quantity squared, they meant something different. If we had a negative out in front, it was not included. It stayed, and I was just squaring the 3. Here, I'm squaring the whole quantity, so the negative is gone. So this still is important when we're using this conversation below. So number 7, the square root of 100 is a positive 10, because what comes out has to be positive. Number 8, the answer is a negative 10, and somebody goes, wait a minute, what? But remember, this is the same idea as this negative up here in front. This is actually a negative 1 times the square root of 100. So the negative stays. And that's where I've always mentioned to y'all to circle it, so you make sure you keep it. Number 9, again, is asking, what to the 4th power would give me 81? So, again, this isn't one we talked about, but something, again, just stop and guess and check. And 3 works, and since we're dealing with an even root, okay, dealing with what I'm saying there is that the index, the root is 4, which is even, means that I'm going to deal with a positive answer coming out of the radical. Difference between number 9 and 10, this negative is on the outside, and again, that's the same thing as a negative 1 times, so my answer there is a negative 3. Please notice a difference between number 9 and 10. Number 9 and 10, what comes out of the root is a positive number because I'm dealing with an even root. So if I'm dealing with the square root, the 4th root, the 6th root, what comes out of the radical is positive. So that's a good lead in to number 11. This is asking us, what real number would I raise to the fourth power? That would give me a negative 81. There is no real number that I can raise to the fourth power that would give me a negative 81. Because if I did negative numbers, I'd be a negative times a negative times a negative times a negative. So I'm going to circle those so you can see what I mean by that. These two make a positive. These two make a positive. So I can only get a positive answer. So my answer here is there is no real number that works. Later in this chapter, we're going to deal with complex numbers. So some of you kind of remember something about an I. That's going to come into play. But in this section, we're asking for real answers. Going to number 12, the cube root of 8 is 2, because again, 2 to the third gives me 8. Now, I get people that get hung up with number 11 and 13, and I need you to stop and notice there's a difference. Number 11, we are dealing with the fourth root. Number 13, I'm dealing with the cube root. We're asking, what can we cube to give us a negative 8? If we're dealing with an odd root or index, then I am okay with a negative underneath because I can put a negative 2 in there. So a negative 2 times a negative 2 times a negative 2. 4 times negative 2 gives me negative 8. So an odd root, the negative will come out. An even root, I cannot have an even root of a negative number and being asked for a real answer. So please stop, digest it, pause it if you need to. Make sure you understand the difference between number 11 and number 13. Going on to number 14, it's that same idea that this negative is outside the parentheses. So I'm keeping that, and the cube root of 8 is 2, so my answer is a negative 2. These problems y'all are going to do super quick in your homework, but you're going to make careless mistakes. Please stop and make sure you truly, truly understand why did you get it wrong. So looking at our next group, now we're going to add another piece to it. We're going to add dealing with variables. So remember when we're dealing with the square root, we're looking essentially for pairs. I want to get just kind of, again, write on the side here an a piece. So when we have the square root of 4, some of you will think of it as 2 times 2, which is a pair. Some of you think of it as 2 squared to understand that. But we're looking for a pair of them. So, again, I'm going to do this first one a long way. We have x squared, x squared, x squared. So that's going to give me an x, an x, and an x when I take the square root of each one of those individually, which gives me x cubed. The shortcut is you will always look for how many of the group we're talking about. In this case, since it's a square root, we're looking for pairs. So there are 3 pairs of x's. 2 goes into 6 3 times. And that's what we have. It goes into it evenly. So again, just different ways to think of those pieces. So this gave me 1, this gave me 1, this gave me 1. That's the longer way to talk about it. Up here, again, you're saying how many pairs did you have? So here, there are 4 pairs, right? Because that's how I would deal with that. So there are 4 of those. Again, just a different way to see that format. 2 goes into 8 4 times. It goes into it evenly. Now, something I like to use for these, I do these slightly different than she does them. I say to you, look for perfect squares. So that's why having that list beside you that I talked about before, having that list to look for these perfect squares. So 25 is a perfect square and I circle it. X to the 14th will have a perfect square into it. So square root of 25 is 5. Square root of x to the 14th, we have 7 pairs of them. That's my answer. The reason why I circle them is so that I know that when I circle them, they're coming out, which means less will be there. So 18 is a cube root. Be careful. So this is a perfect cube root, which is negative 2. And this is where you have to be really careful. X to the 12th. I'm looking for groups of 3. So there are 4 groups of 3. Because 3 goes into 12 4 times. That is my answer. Because I actually have x to the 4th cubed underneath that. 19 through 24 is using, again, a shortcut that I like to talk about. And so remember, what's coming out of an even root is always a positive. So that's why they like to show you that it's an absolute value. And again, that's where you got to be careful. If it's an even root, what comes out has to be positive. If it's an odd root, the negative can come out. So if the index matches the exponent, essentially they cancel out. But what comes out, this is an even, so 7 comes out. 20 is odd, so whatever is there is going to come out. Same thing for 21. Since it's odd, whatever is raised in being raised to that power, because they have to match for this rule to match to work. Number 22 is the one that y'all have got to slow down on. This is an even index. So the absolute value, because what comes out has to be positive. 23 is an odd, so the negative 2 comes out. 24 is even, so positive. Only a positive can come out of an even root. But it really is important that you differentiate between this problem and the one that we said not real. This one has this raised in parentheses. So if I actually were to do this in my calculator, we would actually raise this to the 4th power, which would get rid of the negative, and then we would take the root.